can't put it there. I'm gonna try to trying to find a spot where I don't knock it or something.
You need a sense before.
God woke us up. He gave us another day, didn't he?
Yep. Almost always.
Jennifer, I'm glad you're here. Welcome.
On and on and on and on it goes.
unfailing love endures forever. Amen. I am convinced that neither death nor life nor principalities or powers or whatever would come cannot separate us from the love of God that's found in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, He's my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, He's my song. You are good, good, good. 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 Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves, oh, He is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, oh, He is my song.
Sometimes the darkness wants to hold on, doesn't it? God is stronger.
Yeah. Welcome. Thank you for joining us online and being here today. Another glorious day God's created. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, the song, Let the King Be, you know, if we keep God in a box, He can't be those things to us, what the song said. He wants to be those things. And we can't compartmentalize Him, just keep Him contained. He wants to do more, give more. Let me ask this question. Have you ever been in a relationship where you wanted to give more, but the other person wasn't willing to receive more? How'd that make you feel? Yeah, Jesus, no matter what, whether we receive Him or not, fully or partially, He still pursues us because He wants us. He craves our affection. He wants to save us and spend eternity with Him. So as we continue to worship Him, let's get Him out of the box. Don't put Him in the box anymore. Let's worship Him for who He really is and truly wants to be in our lives.
I've been set free.
not forsaken. All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole, empty-handed but not forsaken. Amazing grace. I mean, when we come to God, we're pretty empty-handed, aren't we? I mean, what do we have? Your love is precious. Your love is all I need. Your love surrounds me. Your love astounds me. Your love is everything. I run to you. My
Lord, we just lift you up. Holy, 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 the name above all names, the one to be revered. For the nail-pierced hands and the wounded side, the evidence of your true love for us, for the lost, and for the sinner. We give you all the praise, the honor, and glory. And even though we fall short every day, Lord, you are still there, walking beside us, supporting us, helping us to grow, to spread your love and to spread your word to a lost and dying world, Lord. Our hope and glory lies in spending eternity with you. Give us the strength, give us the energy, pour upon us your spirit, give us wisdom to pursue a true love that you have given, the perfect love, for the blood that was shed, that flowed on the ground, shook the earth, Lord, but yet you still love us no matter what. We thank you, Lord, for that blessing. Amen. Ron will be continuing his message series on 5 Habits of Highly Missional People, Surprise the World. So let's transition and prepare our hearts and minds for the message.
Well, good morning. We having a good day? How many know that God's in a good mood today? Isn't it good that God's in a good mood? His mercies are new. Most of the time, is that right? What is it? His mercies are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. David talks about it in the Psalms that his anger only lasts for a moment, but his favor for a lifetime. Aren't you glad that we have a daddy like that? He doesn't stay angry. He lasts for a moment. Sometimes he just gets miffed and ticked off, but he gets over it. And if he would treat us according to our sins, who could stand? And then when we ask him to forgive us, what happens? He is just and holy to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then it says that he remembers our sin no more. So after you have asked him to forgive you, and the devil brings that back to your mind, and you say, oh yeah, Lord, forgive me for that. He'll say, I don't know what you're talking about, because he doesn't remember it anymore. He says, what are you talking about? I don't know. You didn't do anything. Aren't you glad that our Father looks at us through the blood of Jesus? Through the blood. You are clean in his eyes. Well, how was this week? We've been in this conversation about having a missional lifestyle. That one of the very purposes that we are on this earth is to be light and salt. Isn't that right? I remember thinking about this way back when, right after I became a believer in Jesus, that I could learn so much more about God and the things of God if there weren't any distractions. That after he saved me, he could translate me to heaven. And then I wouldn't have to be concerned about anything else. I could just really get into God and the things of God. But that's not why we're on this earth. Yes, we are to learn about God. We are to grow in God. But the reason that you and I are on this earth is to pass it on, is to be light, is to be salt. That's why we're on this earth. Every Christian is a witness. Now, exactly what kind of witness you and I are? That's another story. But our life speaks. Paul talks about it in Corinthians, that our life gives off the odor of Christ. That when we walk into the room, the aroma of Christ, excuse me. Not odor, but sometimes we give off another odor. But when we walk into some rooms, we give off another type of aroma, don't we? How many know this? If you haven't been with Jesus for a while, you walk in, then all of a sudden, what's that perfume that you have on? What's that cologne you have on? That don't smell like Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus looks good on you.
Jesus looks good.
Wear him well. Put on Jesus. You know, Jesus looks really good on you. The life we now live, we live by faith in the Son of God. That's how we start out. You mean God might forgive me? You mean He actually would clean me up? That's a step of faith, isn't it? That He'd actually come inside me and empower me to follow Him? That's a step of faith. That He'd actually use my mouth to somehow bless somebody else or use my life to encourage a neighbor? That's a step of faith. God wants to do extraordinary things through ordinary people. Reminds me of the story when the Sanhedrin in Acts. There was Peter and there was John. And the Sanhedrin didn't like what they were saying because they were proclaiming Jesus. And it says they looked at these two men and that they realized that they were ordinary, unschooled people. And the only difference that they had in their life is that they had been with Jesus. You don't have to have a great education. You don't have to have amazing gifts and talents. You come as you are. Jesus wants to use ordinary, everyday people. Some years ago, one of our small groups was meeting over in Worcester, and there was somebody that came for the first time. And I talked to him afterward, and I was glad that they came. And I said, any reflections? And the person was rather bold in a kind of a strange way. They said, the people here are a bunch of flakes. I'm just down. Did you ever see a snowflake? That in the sun, it's so beautiful. All you have to be is a flake. And in the eyes of God, you've got beauty. Mm-hmm. And you know, a nice little snowflake doesn't do much, does it? It just comes down and you barely feel it. But you know, you put a lot of flakes together, you can arrest a whole city. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. You put a whole lot of flakes together, the whole atmosphere changes. And if God's people would start coming together, everything would change. We just need to be blown by the wind of the Spirit. All right, let's get into it. Here's our passage of Scripture that we've been looking at. You are the light of the world. And let's say this one together. It's from Matthew 5. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. When someone lights a lamp, she puts it on a table or a desk or a chair, and the light illumines the entire house. You are like that illuminating light. Let your light shine everywhere you go, that you may illumine creation so men and women everywhere may see your good actions, may see creation at its fullest, may see your devotion to me, and may turn and praise your Father in heaven because of it. How do you like that? May see creation at its fullest. Did you know that you are the apex of God's creation? I remember the first time I went through Colorado, I was in my VW Volkswagen. It was in the fall. The evergreens were green. The aspens were golden yellow. The sky was pristine blue. And there were the mountains. I had praise music on. It was instrumental. And the tears were just coming down my eyes because it was, the beauty was just so much for me. I sensed God's presence in His creation. Do you see God's presence in people? Because that's what Jesus didn't die for the trees. He didn't die for the mountains. He didn't come for the aspen trees. He came for you and I. We are made in the image of God, but through our own choices, we are marred images. And because of Jesus, He can make us beautiful. He already saw it before He ever created us. And you and I are that witness that we would reflect the glory of God, and people would be excited to come to God because they'll say, "What happened to you? Who are you?" Let's keep going. I can't get long-winded. Michael Frost says, "We are here. We are here on this earth to live our lives in such an intriguing manner that will shock, surprise, and provoke those who don't know Jesus to question their own beliefs and to enter into a dialogue with us. Here's the central issue for us to consider. We're doing it all wrong if no one ever asks us any questions about our lives. If our lives look pretty much like any other respectable, law-abiding citizen, what's so intriguing about that? What is with that?" You might say, "Well, how do I get to that place?" The glow of Jesus needs to come off of us. But if we are never in His presence, or rarely in His presence, it doesn't work. How many know this? It just doesn't work. We're trying to, quote, be somebody we're not. We need time with Jesus. When we start to spend time with Jesus and get to know Him, guess what happens? We get to know ourselves. Because many people say, "I don't even know who I am." You spend time with Jesus and you get to know Him. It was like Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6. All of a sudden, he was in the temple. King Uzziah had died. It was a sad day. He was a good king. But Isaiah was in the temple, and all of a sudden his eyes opened up and he had an encounter with God. And he says he saw the Lord. Ha! high lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. God said, yeah, King Uzziah died, but I'm the king and I'm here. And when he saw the Lord, he said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Because there were these cherubim around. They were declaring this. And he says, I'm undone because I've seen the Lord. And I am a man of unclean lips. All of a sudden, when he saw God, he saw himself. I am a man of unclean lips. He was the prophet. What do you mean? His lips should be pretty cleansed, right? He's speaking God's word. But when he's in the presence of God, he saw himself. And then one of those angels took one of the embers out of the flame of the fire of God and put it on his tongue. Psht! And he cleansed him. He says, I have unclean lips, and I might live among a people of unclean lips because I've seen the Lord. And then he's just before the Lord, and the Lord is saying, who can go for us? Who is going to be my witness in this world? And Isaiah says, here I am. Send me. It's in the middle of when we are in God, we see ourselves, we find our calling. We know why we're on this earth. Nobody can do this. No church can do this. No book is going to do this. No program is going to do this. God Himself will do this. Who's going to go for us? God said in Isaiah. He says, here I am. Send me. When you are in that moment before God, it's like nothing else matters. You know God is more powerful than anything. Nothing else matters. Your worries don't matter. Nothing else matters. You're before Him. It is a place of peace. It is a place of serenity. It's a place of wholeness before God. And then the Lord begins talking to Isaiah. It says, you know, I'm going to send you among a people that have ears, but they can't hear. That they have eyes, but they can't see. Oh, my goodness. How many know this? You start talking about Jesus to people, they don't hear. They don't see you. They don't see what you're saying. They think you're weird. They think you're crazy. They think you're a Jesus freak. They think you're this. They think you're a that. They think you're someone else. And you know what? You've been with God. That's why you know. But it's with that relationship with God that we not only find out who we are and what our calling is, we find out how to talk to people. And that's what we're going to get into today. Because our assignment, you know what our assignment is. Did you complete your assignment? Invite people to eat? Yes. Okay. Hallelujah. You know, this is mission is not something we do. It flows out of a relationship of who we are in Jesus. Because every one of us is doing mission work every day. The question is, what are people seeing in us? We are all doing mission work. Every day. All the time. Okay, our assignment, bless at least three people a week, at least one of whom is not a member of our church. Eat with several people a week, at least one of whom is not a member of a church. I said, man, this is a tall task. My whole life has to be in Jesus. Ah, touchdown. Okay. Okay, now I think we're getting it now. Maybe I have to die.
Do I have to die to myself? And my ways? No, you don't have to. You get to. Right? We get to. Then we can start living the one true life. The life that you never thought you could ever live and ever touch. And it's amazing when God starts using you and speaking to you and speaking through you to others. Let's keep going. Here's a clip.
And he became this like prophet for eventually what would become Christianity. And then at the age of 32, he died on the cross. And it's like 3 days later, he was resurrected.
I don't have an opinion on Jesus. I believe that religion was just created to control the masses, really.
Jesus is our Lord and Savior that died on the cross for us, for our sins.
Jesus is a person that existed that continues to enrich the lives of people every day.
Jesus is God's son, and he was sent to save our sins.
I think he is a pretty cool guy. He had a peaceful philosophy. I think he's misinterpreted by a lot of people.
He's the savior of this world.
I don't know, because I don't really believe in him, so I don't really think anything of him.
He could have been a real person. I'm sure he was. I'm sure he was just, good at what he did or something.
I feel that Jesus is a modern day scapegoat.
Jesus is God, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just learned that.
Jesus was a man, from what I figure.
Who is Jesus? He was a dude, lived back in the day. Pretty awesome, he had a beard.
He was just kind of a guy with a really unique, positive message as that kind of gave a lot of people a lot of hope.
He probably existed, but I don't believe that he was the son of God or anything.
He died on the cross for us and saved us and rose again from the dead.
Don't want to sound smart, but...
sort of the man on the street, and they went out, and just who is Jesus? That Asian-looking gal, she said, he was the son, wasn't he? Yeah, I think he is. I want to talk to her, man. She's like way open. And she doesn't really know. Who is Jesus? That's the really question. Isn't that the question that Jesus asked his disciples? Who do men say that I am? Well, they did the little man on the street, some Elijah, some Jeremiah, maybe one of the prophets. And he said, who do you say that I am? Back then, they didn't have the New Testament, so they couldn't give the scriptural answer. Who do you know him to be? Don't go thinking about Bible verses. They're okay, but who do you know him to be? That's all you can talk about. You can't talk about anything else other than what you really know him to be. Isn't that right? You can't talk about that he's a great healer, really, if you haven't been healed in some way. You can't talk about him being a savior unless he really saved you. That you were drowning and lost. You can't talk about him being the lover of your soul if you don't know that he loves you. All we can talk about with others is what we know him to be. I can talk to you about Joe Biden. I can talk to you about what the press says. I can talk to you about what the Republicans say. I can talk to you about what the Democrats say. I can talk to you about what other world leaders say. But I can't talk to you about who he really is, because I don't know him. I don't know the man. I could talk to you about Donald Trump, with the Republicans or the Democrats or other people or world leaders or maybe even his wife says. But I can't talk to you about who he really is. I could talk to you about Barack Obama. And we can go on and on and on. The depth of what we share with others about Jesus and the impact has a lot to do with who we know he is and what he's done with us. That's about it. Isn't that right? We can bless others. We can have others to our house. But the biggest impact down the road, it's going to be, why are we doing this and who Jesus really is? Who is he really? Let's keep going. This right here, yeah. We bless, eat. Today we're going to talk about listen and learn. We're talking about, you know, we need to bless people. We need to strengthen people, encourage people. We need to invite people into a relationship and eat with them. Not just a one-time thing. The one-time thing is the icebreaker. It's this ongoing conversation. We need to listen and learn. We need to listen to God and have a connection with him and learn about who he really is. This is at the heart. You notice that's kind of in the middle there. This is at the heart of truly being missional. What would cause someone to go across the ocean, learn a brand new language, and try to share Christ with others? What would motivate them? There has to be something deep within inside of them to leave everything and go and follow Jesus. And there has to be something deep inside of us to leave our lives and be a witness in this world. There has to be. So let's just pick it up. Do you want God to use you? That's a good question. How many want, do you want God to use you? You want God to use you? I mean, it sounds like a pretty easy thing to, oh yeah, I want God to use me, I want God to use me. Well, let's look at the next slide. Jesus called his disciples. He went up on the mountainside. He prayed all night, as Luke says. And he called to him those who he wanted. Did you know that Jesus wants you? Let's just consider that. Did you know that you think you came to Jesus, God is looking for you. God is looking for men and women. He doesn't say, clean your act up. You go into the military, you got to be a certain weight. And you got to be a certain height. If you're not tall enough, you can't get in the military. Did you know that? If you're not within a certain weight scheme, you can't get in the military. If you got certain imperfections, if you have a pin in your leg, you can't get in the military. Remember the military signs? You know, we're just looking for a few good men. They used to have these military signs, looking for a few good men. I think they're looking for a few good men and women now.
God said, you don't have to be good. I already know who you are. You try to clean your, you gotta press me. I'm just looking for people that are willing and available. Okay, so here he is. He came down from the mountain. He called those whom he wanted, and they came to him. He appointed 12. Now look at this first one. That they might be with him. The first call of God. This is first base. He wants a relationship with us. With us. He's called us to be with him. Not to do something for him. He's calling us into a relationship with him. How many know in baseball, if you want to get to second base, you got to touch first base. Many people don't go to first base. Or they sort of just maybe go close to first base and have sort of a relationship. But they want to go, I want to do something for God. We're very do-oriented. God says, I don't want you to do anything. I want you to come to me. I want you to be with me. Let's go back to this passage. Look at this. They came, he appointed 12 that they might be with him. And then, after being with him, just like Isaiah, having an encounter with him, then he sent them out. Then he sent them out, and then they have authority to drive out demons. Remember on the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus was talking? Many will say to me on that day, we cast out demons in your name, and we did many mighty things in your name. And he says, I never knew you. Remember that? I never knew you. Knowing Jesus, there is no greater thing. There is no greater thing. This is one of the missing keys, pieces of evangelism, of a life lived for God. Let's keep going. Do you want God to use you? I'm going back to this one. Yeah. Okay. All right. Next slide. And he said to them, He went out on the Sea of Galilee, and there was Zebedee and his sons, and Peter. They were fishing. And he says, guys, follow me. This is the Amplified. Accept me as your master, teacher, and walking the same path and life that I walk. And guess what? I'm going to make you fishers of men. Fishers of men. I don't even think they know what they were getting into. Immediately. Say immediately.
Immediately.
They didn't say, I'll call you back. Oh, you know, where are you going to be tomorrow? We'll have a talk. Can you imagine Zebedee? There's this James and John, who was the sons of Zebedee. They left. He had a fishing business. Peter left. They all left. Immediately. They left their nets and followed him, becoming his disciples, believing, trusting in him, following his example. Man, they left. This is the call of God. From the very beginning, it's leave and go. We have to leave our life and go follow him. Leave our life and be with him. Leave our life. And wasn't that Abraham?
says God called him to leave his family and leave his country and go to a place they don't even know where you're going. Most of us want to know what we're getting into before we get into it. How many know that you rarely know what you're getting into before you get into it? Come on.
Yeah.
Isn't that the way it is? Isn't that way it is in business? Isn't that way it is in relationships? Isn't that way it is in marriage? You know what you're getting into until you get into it. When I was traveling on the road, we were in Columbus, Ohio. It was the strangest thing. They needed a trumpet player, and the guy called me up from Columbus. He says, "You got your trumpet right there? I want to hear it over the phone." So I put the phone down there. I played some things. He said, "You sound pretty good to me. You're hired." Whoa. And then they say, you know, you'll go here, you know, because I did. I went to the top of the Twin Towers. I was up there at the Windows of the World restaurant, the very top of one of the towers. It was beautiful up there. They have this elevator that minute and a half, you're from the bottom all the way up, and it's just like, woo, you just hold on, man. It was a big full freight elevator, had all our equipment on there, and wham, you just go up. And it's beautiful. There's windows all the way around this thing, windows of the world. And there was some convention up there, private convention. They fed us. But you know, we went like from New York City to Minot, North Dakota. And then in a day and a half, we're supposed to be down in Miami, Florida. And guess what? We had to drive. We drove about 98% of the time. And during this thing, we called it the History Fund. The History Fund was that back then, you could take Greyhound bus, $100, you can go anywhere in the continental United States. So we had a History Fund. Everybody had $100. If you had enough, it was called the History Fund. You could just declare history and go home. That was the History Fund. Why? Because you don't know what you're getting into until you get into it. You just don't know what you're getting into. And there was a couple people who actually did the History Fund. I didn't do that, you know. I didn't do that. But we always laughed about it. Do you have $100? No, I don't. He said, "Well, you gotta deal with it. How do you like? Okay, there you are, in the back of a van. You're sleeping in the van. And the last thing you drank at 10 o'clock at night or 11 o'clock at night or 12 o'clock at night was Mountain Dew. And then you wake up, that taste in your mouth. One of the guys called it mung mouth. It seemed to fit. It was mung. That's what we called it. It was mung mouth. I said, oh my goodness. You know? You don't know what you get, but with Jesus, I can tell you what. There will be the ups and the downs, but you will have a life that's worth it. It'll be a clean life. It'll be a good life. It'll be the best life that you could ever find. These guys left, they didn't know what they were getting into, did they? They had their doubts along the way. They had their fears along the way. They thought they were going to drown. They thought that they were going to get killed. They had ups and downs, and in the middle of it, they found and they came to know who Jesus was, and they came to know who they were. Isn't that right? They
They got to know God. They got to know who they were and who they were not. Let's keep going. Do you want God to use you? Do you want God to use you? Yeah? You want God to use you? Let's keep going. Here's a day in the life of Jesus. You ever think you have a busy day? Here's Jesus. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. That's in the morning. Okay, he goes to the synagogue and begins to teach. People were amazed at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an impure spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." Okay, right in the middle of the service. Demons hate Jesus. Shrieking out at a person. Jesus said, "Be quiet. Come out of him." Okay, next. The impure spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. Wonder how that thing sounded. Ah! You know, whatever it was. You know, you just wonder what kind of shriek was it? The people were so amazed that they asked me, "What is this? A new teaching and with authority? He even gives orders to impure spirits and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. You know, as soon as that meeting was over, man, people, whoo! Guess what's going on? We had church today, but never like before. God was in church today. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. You know who Simon is? Peter, right? Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. "Well, Jesus, she's not doing well." So here it is, Simon's mother-in-law. So you know you can see Simon had a wife. Mm-hmm. Isn't it interesting? This is a side note. Mm-hmm. The first pope of the Catholic Church is Peter, and he was married. Anyway, that's a freebie. let's go. Let's keep going. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. Wow! Demons leave. Sickness leaves. And Jesus is... God is on the scene. That evening, after sunset... Okay, so they had a little time there. Mm-hmm. You wonder what all the conversation was about. I think there was excitement in the air. These new disciples, they didn't know what was going on. Simon's mother-in-law, I bet she had a spring in her step. Look what it says, the whole town gathered. Oh, that evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. Say all.
All.
How many? Roger, you got to come over here. Come on, Roger. You got to see Jesus. You've been sick for all this time. Velma, come on. You got to come in here, Velma. Chester, come on. How many did they bring? Just a couple?
All.
And then it says the whole town. Say the whole town.
The whole town
gathered at the door. What do you think? How many? Nobody's staying home tonight. This rocked this town, Capernaum. This city. Forever changed. Because Jesus came.
Did you know God wants to do that? When you will start walking into people's lives, forever they can change. Because Jesus is what? It says in Hebrews, He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Okay, the whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but He would not let the demons speak because they knew who He was. You don't let demons speak. Okay, how long do you suppose Jesus was up that night? The whole town. All the sick, all the demon-possessed. How long do you think He was up that night?
Most of the night.
What do you think? Two? Three?
Well, He always got up early to pray, so it may have been an all-nighter.
Because look, what it says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where He prayed. How many know if you have an outflow, you got to have an inflow. If the inflow stops, the outflow stops. Because you ain't giving Jesus no more, you're giving something else. You're giving Jesus out here. You got to get retooled and refilled. Okay, so Jesus knew He needed His connection with His Father. Right? He got up. Look at the next passage. Simon and his companions went to look for Him. And when they found Him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Duh, Simon. That's why I didn't tell you where I was going. I didn't want to be with anybody else. I had an appointment with my Father. How many of us have an appointment with our Father? We shut the cell phones off, turn the TV off, turn the radio off, turn the music off. We're not with other people. It's between us and God. Because look what Jesus says. Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else to the nearby villages so I can preach there also. That is why I've come." Do you think it's a possibility that Jesus thought, maybe God moves so much here, maybe we need to set up shop here in Capernaum? The whole city is going bananas for God. But God says, no, that's not why I called you. You need to go. You need to keep going where I've sent you. So He traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out the demons. How many of us, after we have such a breakthrough, we assume what the next step is? We assume we know what we're doing. When things are going great, we assume we know what's happening. There was a correction there before anything could ever happen. He knew He needed to hear God. He knew He needed to hear His Father. Let's keep going. You want God to use you? Yeah? Want God to use you? Some of you are smiling and say, man, this is getting old. No, it's not. Do you want God to use you? Let's keep going. The deeper you go in God, the higher you'll go in God. How many know that when you, like when they had the Twin Towers, I talked about them, How far do you suppose they dug down?
I remember reading somewhere it was 10 stories.
10 stories down?
Down.
In order to go up with God, we got to dig down. The farther you dig down, the higher you go up with God. You got to dig down. You got to dig. The deeper you go in God, the higher you'll go in God. Isn't that right? If you want to go to high places with God, you got to get down with God. You got to turn everything off, and you got to know that you know that you know in your knower what God is talking about. Because you're going to stake your life on it. You got to know what you're doing. Because other people will come against you. And sometimes it'll be your friends. Other people will come against you, and there'll be all sorts of other ideas that even sound better. But you don't want a good idea, you want a God idea. You don't want good things, you want God things. Let's keep going. Tell me who you know Jesus is, not what you know about Jesus. Because the deeper you go, you'll know who Jesus is. Don't tell me about Jesus. Don't share others about Jesus. Share others who you know Jesus is. Because that's the only real thing you have to share. We got to be authentic. We got to be real. Or else people will see right through us. And when we are real, that's when we have a testimony. That's a testimony. Nobody can take that away from us. All right, next. We can't share with others about Jesus until we really know who He is. Isn't that right? We can't share with others about Jesus until we know who He is. I remember being up in my bedroom. I'm 19 years old. I had a habit. Ever since I came to know Jesus at 16, I would come home from school. I'd go up to my bedroom and I'd start reading the Bible, and it was like God just talking to me. And everything where I knew that God was talking to me, I'd underline it. And I was just underlining about everything, it seemed. It was, God was speaking to me. This one particular day, when I was before God, 18, 19 years old, all of a sudden I had this vision. It was near somebody's house that I knew where this was. And the Lord began to talk to me that there was this boy that lived just down the road from them. And then I needed to tell him about Jesus. This boy that I didn't know. That I never met. I remember saying, okay, God, if this is you, let this boy be out there. So I got in my car. I drove over there. I parked on the street. And there the boy was. I said, okay, God. I just began talking with him. I don't even know what I said to him. He had different animals there and all this, and they invited me over to eat. They just invited me right in, and I had supper with them. I had a campus life meeting that evening. And then I shared it with them and I said, would you like to come with me? By the time I got there, they were like almost done. And then I was kind of wanting him to be there. And then on the way back, God was telling him, just ask him, do you know Jesus? Would you like to know who Jesus is? And I did, and he said, yes. I said, wow. Now this is how you do it for us. You got to hear God. You get this thing from God, and then it just falls on itself. So we went by this church, and I knew the doors were open, and we walked in, and I talked to him about Jesus, and I knew the plan of salvation. He prayed the prayer, asked Jesus to come into his heart. I said, wow. When you're before God, sometimes God talks about you. Sometimes he talks about other people. Sometimes he says, you know, that person that you talk to. Because that's what God did to me once. I went to the gas station and got gasoline. And as soon as I left, God says, you know that guy that pumped gas in your vehicle? That was back when they pumped gas in your vehicle. You know that guy that pumped gas in your vehicle? I want you to tell him about Jesus. I said, how do you do that? Man, he's working. And then the thought came in my head, I needed to give him this little track that really talked all about Jesus. I said, give it to him and then ask him if he read it the next time you come back. I said, wow. I said, I really didn't want to do this. So the next time I drove past that gas station, I had all this conviction over me. And I knew there was a block between God and I. So the next time, I took roads around that place because I didn't want to feel that conviction again. I did. I went around this place. I went around the gas station. I didn't want to feel this thing. And I said, okay, God. If this is you, he needs to be there and come out. I parked it, and lo and behold, the guy comes out. And then I go back in and pay, and then I just pull out a track, and I said, would you read this track? It talks about God, and then we can come back another time, and then we can talk about it. He said, sure. He took it, and I came back another time, and I said, did you read that? And he says, yeah. I said, there was a prayer in there. Did you ask Jesus to come in your heart? And he said, no, I didn't. I said, do you want to? He says, yeah, I did. So we went back in this back room where this mop bucket was. And it was a holy place. And right there, he asked Jesus to come into his life. You start doing stuff like that. But it's all born out of a personal connection with God. Let's keep going.
You drive up. You feel uncomfortable. Avoid eye contact. Don't look at him. wait for an eternity for the light to change? Would it make a difference if you knew he wouldn't buy alcohol? Would it make a difference if you knew he was suffering from a debilitating mental illness? Would it make a difference if you knew he wanted a job? Look at him. Look into his eyes. In this short moment, are you brave enough? What if he was God's son?
Let's say you go by that place every time, just like I was with that gas station. Obviously, he's getting some sort of conviction. Something's stirring up in this guy. And what do? You kick it out? When you get conviction, you kind of just toss it off to the side? Or you say, God, I really need to talk to you. I got a problem. And I don't know what to do with it. What do you want? It's not my life, God. What do you want? What do you want? And then you dare follow the promptings. Sometimes I've seriously questioned the promptings, and then I ask other Christians, could this be God? And sometimes Christians are good about telling you, and sometimes Christians say, you don't want to do that. You know what I mean? And you might not get good news from other people. You really press in to hear God. Let's keep going. Here's Paul in Romans. I will not venture or dare to speak of anything except what Christ has accomplished through me. I'm not going to talk about anything with anybody except what God's done right here in my life. I'm not going to be insincere. I will not talk about anything I did myself. I will talk only about what Christ has done through me. I'm going to talk about what he's done in my life. We can't talk about other things. He says, I'm not going to dare talk about anything else. That's real. That's Jesus. You know, the question is, do we have anything to talk about? Do we have anything life-shattering to talk about with other people? Because if it's not about theology, it's not about what a scripture says, it's about who Jesus really is in you and what he's really done in you and how he's changed you and how he wants to not only speak to you, but through you to others. Next. Here's Jesus. It's in Matthew. Remember the place that he says, when you pray? Don't pray out in the open in front of everybody so you can be seen. But when you pray, go into a quiet place and shut the door and pray with your Father, with you and your Father in heaven. This is the message. So when you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production. You ever been around sometimes when people turn prayer, almost doing a theatrical production when they pray in front of everybody. It's all flowery. It's all this and it's all that. Yeah, it is. It's flowery. And they never say these and thous, but when they pray to God, they do. It's weird. But anyway, here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense His grace. Get quiet. I recommend a block of time. A block of time is like a morning, an afternoon, or an evening. Block it all out. It's God and I time. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are prayer ignorant. They're full of formulas and programs and advice, peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. Phew, what do you think? Huh? Next passage, or next slide. Quiet your soul and listen. Psalm 46:10, surrender your anxiety, be still, and realize that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still. Some of us, we don't know how to be still. There is a discipline of prayer and solitude and silence that we need before God. Prayer is not, the kind of prayer that I'm talking about is not you talking to God about yourself. Real prayer. Prayer that's totally different is when God's talking to you. That's what I'm talking about. That is the prayer that I'm talking about. And you might say, I don't, you have to struggle to get there. You're going to have to press in to get there. It's going to take effort to get there. You're going to have to totally get over yourself to get there. Once you get there and you taste that, you never want anything else. That's the living water. Mark 6, Jesus says to his disciples, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. Or here in Psalm 32, I will teach you and tell you the way to go and how to get there. I will give you good counsel and I will watch over you. Don't be stubborn and stupid like horses and mules who, if not reined by leather and metal, will run wild, ignoring their masters. God's going to get your attention one way or another. It'll be through leather or metal or His voice. God would prefer to talk to us through His voice rather than exterior things that rein us in. Or John 13, but when the truth-giving Spirit comes, He will unveil the reality of every truth within you. God will talk to you, every truth within you. He won't speak in His own, but only what He hears from the Father. And He will reveal prophetically to you what is to come. That's what I'm talking about. He's going to reveal to you what is to come. God will speak to you. He's going to reveal every truth within you. That's what He wants. Great passages. I just have a token of passages here. There's so many more. Okay, next frame. Nurture the habit of learning and listening. It's going to take time to nurture the habit of learning about God and listening. You might say, you know, what are some of the biggest problems? Yeah, sin can be a problem. But I'll tell you what I think are some of the biggest two problems is fear and laziness. We're too lazy to spend time to give him time. And we're afraid. God might talk to me about something that I don't want to do. Fear of persecution, fear of standing out or causing offense, fear of having to answer someone's tricky questions, fear will shut down mission engagement every time. Fear that, did I really hear God? Did I really not hear God? Take the step and say, you know, I've done this before. I'm not sure if I've heard God. And I say, I don't know if I've heard God or not. You know, I don't even, sometimes I don't even use God's name. Say, I just sense I need to talk to you about this. Does that ring a bell for you? Or I just test the water sometimes. Because I can't say that I have it all. And I know. I just test the water. Laziness tells you that you don't have time. Laziness whispers to you, you need to take care of yourself first. Laziness tells you, why bother reaching out? Why do this? I've tried listening to God. I can't hear him. I don't know if it really makes that big of a deal. Yes, it does. Look at this next. This is Jesus saying, the sheep that are my own will hear and are listening to my voice. My sheep know my voice. My sheep listen and hear my voice. And I know them and they follow me. Look that up in all sorts of translations. John 10:27. My sheep hear my voice. If you are a sheep, if you're his little sheepy, you can hear his voice. I want to know that I know that I know that I hear God. Okay, this is a promise, God. I want to hear your voice. All right, next slide. Michael Frost says, if you're an outcomes-oriented person, you'll be desperate to get to the point of it. You'll be desperate to get to the point of it and ask the Spirit to grant you knowledge or wisdom or courage or righteousness or whatever you think you need in your current circumstance. Some of us are impatient. Okay, God, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to do this or that or this or this other thing or this? You know, just tell me what to do, God. Just tell me what to do, God. And God says, no, I want a relationship with you. It's not about what you... Just abide in his presence. Let his love wash over you. Just stay with him and connect with him. Just stay with him and connect with him. What happened? Oh, crap. Yeah, now that's on now. All right, well, because we got offline, right?
No, we're still on system.
Okay, we're online, but we have no picture, right? Sometimes it doesn't turn right back on.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to wait because it's hot.
It's illustrating patience.
Well,
keep
no, I don't know. Can they see? Is that on?
Yeah, you're still
on. Okay. Well, because you're not, because I can't see anything, because I don't know anything yet. What you guys tell me? Okay. Anyway, enough of that. It's in Hebrews 11:6. The passage of Scripture says that no one will come to God unless they believe that He is. And that it's worth being with him. And no one comes to God and seeks him unless it is well worth being with him. If you don't think it's worth being with God, you're not going to be with him. You have to believe he is worth spending time with. That's what the Phillips translation says. If you don't believe that God is worth spending time with, you're not going to do it. If you believe that He is worth spending time with, you will do it. Other translation says, you must believe that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. If you don't believe that He will reward you and it will be worth it to spend time with Him, you're not going to do it. Amen? Okay, next slide. This is it in Hebrews 11:6. The man, the woman who approaches God must have faith in two things. First, that God exists, and secondly, that it is worth a man or a woman's while to press in and find God. Is it worth your while? Is it worth your while? Yeah. And that is a key, isn't it? Okay, next slide. Michael Frost says, my experience when engaging with my neighbors is that I must open my heart to the Holy Spirit in order to separate truth from untruth, fiction from knowledge, the honorable from the dishonorable. Figuring out how best to be an intriguing, blessing, godly presence in community isn't easy. If I'm going to encourage you to bless others and eat with them, it would be irresponsible of me not to also encourage you to listen to the Spirit. Amen. I thought that was written really well. All right. Next slide. No. So some key ideas in the listening and the learning. Set aside a block of time. Eliminate distractions. Turn your phone off. Don't have music on. Don't have the TV on. Close your door. If there's others in the house, say, don't disturb me. Sometimes you have to get out of there. Go to the park. You and God walk. Ask God to come in. Let God in. Ask God to come in. I want to connect with you, God. If you know there's no sin in your life, talk about it. Ask Him to forgive you. Say, I'm not here for me, God. I'm here for you. I'm not asking for a word. I want to connect with you. I want to know you. Open the Bible, read, pause. Sometimes God speaks right through His Word. All of a sudden, something out of the page just jumps out. Remember, God's agenda is not your agenda. Let your agenda go. What is the front burner issue with you may not be a front burner issue with Him at all. His front burner issue may have nothing to do with what you think the front burner issue is. He's trying to get your attention to talk to your neighbor when you're thinking this little thing over here is the most important thing. Or he's trying to point out something else in your life when you're all weirded out about this other thing. Weirded out. Don't we get that way? Follow God's promptings. Write down and chew over what you believe God is saying. I've had people before say, you know, just start praying. Just start praying and write what you have to say with this pen. And it was black ink. When you sense God is talking, change pens and pick up the blue ink. And start writing it down. Those of us that journal, that is a good thing. And I remember the person, because they were questioning whether they heard God, and all of a sudden they brought this in, and it was blue, and the tears just started coming to their eyes as they start talking about how this was God talking to them about. It was God. These are some good ideas. All right, next slide. spend at least one block of time listening to the Spirit and learning about Jesus. And chew it down, follow the promptings, and just obey. Let's pray. Father, thank you for who you are. You are an awesome and a wonderful God. I pray that you would have us to trust you, that it is worth our while to press in and seek you. That we would say, I am going to hear God, I am going to have a connection with him, I am going to seek him, and I'm going to find him, and he's going to find me. That's where life begins. That's where grace becomes brand new. That's where truly evangelism springs out of. Thank you, Father. Forgive us, Lord, that we have neglected you. The living water. And have dug for ourselves cisterns. Stale water. That's broken down. Help us to choose you, the spring of living water. In Jesus' name, amen.
Making plans, there's so many variables, and are we willing to be flexible when Christ, calls us? At work we'd make flow charts, you go each step, but there's always invariably a variable that you didn't count for. Mm-hmm. So we need to be, are you flexible? Are you willing to let God lead you? And I know one piece of advice Ron gave me a long time ago in preparing for my messages and stuff, he recommended, go narrow and deep, not wide and shallow. When you go wide and shallow, you just aren't getting, you're just spreading yourself out way too thin and you're not getting the content. So if you go narrow and deep, you're going to keep your focus. And when we talk about Christ, we set the atmosphere. The atmosphere is what really makes a difference in a person's life. If people are willing to receive, but it's the atmosphere of how you convey that. I know for me, I do struggle with being quiet myself in my own ways. I always seem to have something on the background. And I do recall those one time. I got up in the morning, it was before work, and I sat in my recliner. And I really need to get my mind focused. I need to get everything out. So I sat there for just, I don't know, it wasn't very long. And all of a sudden, my mind was empty. There was nothing in the background, no noise, no nothing. And God just, it was like a download, an instant download. And I had all this information coming in, and it was just hard to filter it. But it felt so good, and I felt energized. And I can't remember it all. I can't really remember much now, but I just remember the euphoria, the feeling of it, the excitement that he spoke to me. And it shows that if you do apply yourself, it can happen. It's just a process. And the thing is, I'm going to encourage you is not to beat yourself up if you get over the amount of time. If you can do like 5 or 10 minutes, that's a start. It's good to have a starting point and then build upon that. Don't think you have to do a half hour, hour, whatever. I mean, if God leads you that way the first time, that's great. But that, it helps not beating yourself up. And, I do put time limits on myself, but I'm not going to try and do that anymore. We make a commitment to work every day to provide for ourselves. Let's make a commitment to take time with God. That's the big thing, is making a commitment.
Now, one thing, and I heard about it in Rhema Bible College, what they used to do with their students. I don't know if they do that anymore. That was in Oklahoma. the whole afternoon was set aside for them just to hear God. That's all they had to do. But it was required. And if you did not do it, and earnestly didn't really get into it, you were kicked out. I mean, you couldn't be a part of the program. So when you were saying, you know, just do 5-10 minutes, no, dive into this thing, man. Give a block of time. You know, I think it's okay, but we're going to shortchange it. It's going to be fast food Jesus. And that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about something deep. And you might say, man, that's just radical. Yeah, that's what it needs to be. And I guess I, you know, just like if I would come over to your house, you know, I'll just spend 5 minutes with you and then I leave. How would you feel?
Yeah, no.
I'm gonna spend some time with you, Jeff, and I come over 5 minutes, I'm out of there. Well, I don't know, you know, maybe I'll do it 10 minutes later. Maybe 15 minutes another time, but, you know, I don't know. It's just kind of where I'm at. So, you know, what's wrong with you, Ron? And you might say, well, I don't know what I'm doing with God, but that's where you start. You just start with being honest. Maybe I really don't know you, God. But, you know, I would just, you know, I mean, a block of time. You know, maybe... You might say, well, I really don't know what I'm doing. Well, that's how it starts. But I don't think you're really going to get much places until you're at least 20 minutes into this. And you're not really fidgeting around. It's getting quiet to be able to hear God. And that is a big thing, because many of us have stuff on all the time.
Yeah.
But I'm not here to rebuke you.
I know.
I'm just saying that I want us to go deep, and I think it's impossible with 5-10 minutes. I think it's just impossible. I don't know how to do that. It takes some real time to.
Thank you. Yes. Any announcements then? Let's see. Cell is at My Place Tuesday and
Sam's.
At Sam's. Okay. I do have some daily breads here for June, starting in June. If you grab one here and take some to the cells. And then the first one here, Promise Keepers, is coming up in July.
Coming to Oregon?
Yeah. Well, it's pre-recorded from the weekend before. Yeah, well, it's pre-recorded, so
okay.
We'll get to watch it. So if you're interested, I have flyers here too, the website. If you're watching this home, you can pause it and get the information at that point. So if you want a flyer, got that. And then the next one. There we go. This Friday, the Orville Christian Missionary Alliance is having a movie outside, Ring the Bell, free outdoor movie. So starts at 9:15, and the weather's going to be great. I looked ahead; it's going to be in the 80s all next, or towards the end of the week, close to that. So upper 70s, it'd be a nice day. Check that out if you'd like to go. We'll do the offering then. Lord, thank you for this offering. Thank you for what you've done, Lord, what you will do in this coming week. Lord, help us to hear your voice, to set aside the time and be still. It's the stillness that counts, and Lord, we just have so much going on in our lives, the noise, the background, and the people, and demands. Lord, help us to set it aside to be a commitment to you and to further your kingdom in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Go and have a great week and happy Memorial Day. We'll see you next month.
God bless.
Question. Before we end.